two talks today and three speakers. So without any further ado, sorry for the technical difficulties, and we will also be moving to hopefully a larger space soon, because we had more on the wait list than on the RSVP list because of the limitation of the space. So we will be doing that possibly from the next month's meeting. We are moving to a bigger space, so we'll have meetups. I think that's gone.
Oh.
Okay, it's fine. All right, let's go. So there's Ram and Muthu.
Hi, everyone. Thanks for coming today, listening to us. So today we're going to share our experiences from working on the government space, continuous delivery in government space. So we're going to discuss how the environment is different in a government project versus in a private workspace. So the KPIs, the metrics, the measures of success are very different in a private versus a government environment. For instance, in an e-commerce like environment, the measure of success would be revenue, number of new users, number of products sold, and so on. But in government space, it's completely not that. It's either how stable the environment was, how stable the application was, and how faster did we react to customer feedback, and how high is the customer satisfaction, and so on. In fact, the government project that we experienced, our payments were linked to the customer satisfaction, the user survey. So the measure of success and the metrics they use to measure, yeah, the metrics are all different in government versus private space. And while auditability and traceability are important in both private and government, in government that those are the ones which are of utmost importance. Having control. Control over what is deployed, control over who can deploy, control over everything, and auditability especially. So typically in government space, auditing takes more time than development. So they spend months trying to validate whether what is done is right, and are we compliant with all the policies, rather than productive stuff. That's how a typical government space works. And organizational structure, it's very different, it's very hierarchical. There's role segregation. We say the name DevOps team is a misnomer, but unfortunately that's how it is in government space. Those who do development, those who change business domain logic, cannot deploy to production. So there has to be exclusive role segregation. So what we're going to generally discuss today is how do we still achieve continuous deployment, continuous delivery, with given all these constraints. That's what we're going to focus on. And
coming up, yeah, go on.
So, we know that in a private space, do you want to go to the next slide?
Okay, can.
We know in the private space, success is very clearly defined. There is clarity on our goals. We know our goal is to achieve this much revenue, or these many users at the end of this quarter, and so on. But in government space, there is no such success defined. So how do we still make it successful when nobody is looking for it? That's what this is about. Ram, you want to continue?
Okay. So what we've seen is the uptimes, the performance, user satisfaction, better streamlining of processes. These are the things that everyone is generally focused on. Those who are very forward-minded, at least, right? A very interesting example is in the e-commerce space, right? I mean, we are all very used to things like perform analytics, you know, do some blue-green deployments, you know, do a bit of a 2% testing and see can we increase our user traction and so many other such things. Over here, the metrics are different. One of the things that Muthu had pointed was payments, which are linked to certain other metrics. So when the user is not so much concerned about growth, how do they make sure that the vendors give the right, give them what they need? We realized that, you know, these were the kind of interesting success criteria for them. I tell you that when you come from the e-commerce side, I mean, the bulk of my work has been very e-commerce-ish. Coming from there to this sort of a world was a big change, because when we would give recommendations to them, right, oh, you know, maybe you want to try this, you'd look at each other and say, yeah, you know, that doesn't quite apply to us. That often would be a very interesting surprise. But the better thing was, our experiences were good. There was a lot of focus on improving processes. There would be a lot of wake-up calls, like we would give them showcases very regularly, right? So they would realize, oh, you can do this with computers, is it? Or you can do this in a new way. Okay, maybe we'd like to try it out. So our experiences have been generally very optimistic. But we realize that growth means something else over here. Go ahead, Muthu.
So we spoke about auditing and how auditing is very important. It's the prime thing in government space, right? So, and we also saw like auditing takes typically more time than actual productive development. Most of the developers' time or the infrastructure systems and admins' times is spent on futile arguments with auditors on how we think what we did is the right thing, and while auditors say, oh, no, I need proof and so on. So how we addressed it in this environment with all these constraints is we had hardening embedded in our deployment process. So if government comes up with a security policy, we automate all of it, and every environment, not just production, right from development to QA, UAT, and any environment that we might have, all of it have the same deployment scripts and so on, and all of it is hardened similar to production. And automated auditing reports. What auditors look for is reports to say, it could be CS auditing reports, or it could be any metric that they're looking for. Let's say we have, but auditors are primarily concerned about probably just pre-production and production, but even if we have say 50 servers together in both those environments, generating those reports for every environment and getting the auditor to go through all of it and getting a sign off is a big deal. So automating that also helps. That's what we did.
Yeah. One thing I'd like to add here is the CIS benchmark. Yes, you had a question? Okay. The CIS benchmarks, which are very popular, right? When you have external auditors come and audit you, they say, please run the CIS benchmarks. I tell you, these can be highly misleading, the reports that come, you know, the CIS benchmark reports. It just, they have certain defaults of their own. Okay, if the finding doesn't match that, it's immediately marked as a fail. Even if you are more secure or whatever, let's say it has a policy like, you know, change passwords every 120 days. You would have gone and said, oh, I want to change it every 90 days. It's going to mark it as a failure. And then good luck trying to sit and explain it to certain kinds of, you know, auditors who are not very tech savvy sometimes. The other interesting challenge with the CIS benchmark scripts are that they are often not, their checks are actually not correct. They may not really check for the right stuff, or there'd be some error in the script and it just reports some minus one or something where you actually have values in production. So what we realized was sometimes you can't explain a lot of these things to auditors, so you have to go and come up with some stupid workarounds yourself. Wherein you say, these are going to be known findings, these are what we actually have, this is our script, this is what we checked for, and you know, please when you review this, don't waste your and our time flagging it as a failure and engaging in multiple meetings. Here's what we expect you to see as a failure, and here's what the actual value is, here's the extract of the file. Those actually seem to get us through faster than sitting and debating whether the CI script should be fixed or not.
And one thing I would like to add on that is, because we have hardening embedded in deployment and automated auditing reports, we don't have to wait for auditor to come up with findings. Even before he comes, we know whether it's going to be green or red, as in it's going to pass or fail. So we can, I mean, we get proactive reports, and we know in advance, I mean, if some security policy is not followed, we know it in our development environment and not in production. So that gives us time to fix it. And also, if it is something like known issue, if there are any known issues, then we know it well in advance before the auditor comes and they can be prepared.
Yeah. Our goal in all of this was just make sure that eventually auditing becomes a non-event. Right? So something that we've discovered about Singapore culture, as you can make out, I'm not from Singapore, right? in the other countries I've worked in, right, the metrics were different. It was always about revenue, getting in revenue, making sure you don't have downtimes and so on. Over here, we realized that there's a very intense audit culture, right? You have the external auditors who are invited to audit. You have the government auditors who are invited to audit. And there is this strong feel of, even if you have answers to questions, the fact that questions are raised itself has become a very interesting, you know, it guides a lot of people's behavior. It's fine if, I mean, you would say, hey, someone asked a question, that's good. I've got some responses for them. I got very nice clarifications. But culturally, what we've realized is the fact that even questions were raised in certain groups, that itself becomes a flag. Hey, you know what? Questions are raised, right? So that was very interesting for us, but I don't know. This was a bit of a bad adventure, really. We just had to survive and go through it. So I'd really like to go and look at this very quickly with you. To tell you the truth, I really enjoyed the thing all said and done. You know, sometimes you go through difficulties and you realize, wow, I've learned a lot. We've come up with a better product and we actually have something that's very good. To the extent that I went and gave the exam to become an auditor, and now the paperwork for that is in progress. I cleared the exam and I'm pretty pleased, actually. The reason is, you know, there are some topics that we are going to come up with later, like segregation of duties and network segregation and whatnot. There's a lot of problems that we faced. And my feeling was, instead of sitting and debating it or, you know, calling names or making snide remarks or whatever, that's fine. I'd rather come up with working examples and some revised papers and revised examples by which we can go and influence the industry and say, folks, there are better ways to do it. We can still stick to all the principles, still continue to have the same kind of, we can still continue to protect our assets, but with better ways which are not so painful as they are today. That was our goal. So one of my own realizations was these, right? What is it that security and audit folk do? They are not actually out to give you a difficult time. Because after I got past that barrier, right, where we started to show the auditors a lot of automation. After we got past that barrier where they were a bit skeptical about automation, we generally had a good time with them. To the extent that towards the, for the latter half of our various auditing that we'd go to, we'd be done in about 45 minutes. Imagine what would usually take me about 10 to 12 days, and with evidences another month, and what with other projects I've seen that, you know, they can go a month or longer. Over here, we would now just be done in about 45 minutes. We were just done. That's because we had learned our lessons. So the top thing that we realized is, this is what everyone really wants to know. Okay, the answers to these questions. And if you as a team understand that, hey, if I can have good answers for these which are sound, then you're actually in a good path. The answers to these plus automation and you're good to go, right? So at another meetup last week, one of the people in the audience had asked a good question. What is a good security policy? So I gave a whole lot of answers, but one of the guys, Stefan, he said, by the way, a good security policy is also one that can be codified. If you can express your security policy in a code form and be able to run that regularly and review it, then you have a security policy that can be live versus a security policy that's just a bunch of documents, painfully filled, painfully reviewed, but perhaps not updated on time, right? So how did we win? How did we win the trust of the various auditors that we worked with? The top thing that we did was we showed them that as much as possible, we are going to follow revision control. We're going to make sure that our entire revision control and the process beyond that is fully automated. We are going to make sure that we provide all the assurances that everyone needs in terms of how good is your code? Are you coding the right stuff? Are there any shortcuts that you have put in? Is there any backdoor that you have snuck in? Right? So we made sure that first we explain all of those things on the next few slides to the auditors. We started with this, saying that at an application level, this is what we have at the very minimum. We make sure that we have the test-driven approach to writing unit tests, which developers author, which QAs also contribute to by way of saying, I will be checking for these things. we make sure that all our services and inter-service calls, we make sure that we have the right kind of tests over there. We demonstrated that for end-to-end workflows, also we have tests. An end-to-end workflow test is something like, I would like to take an e-commerce example where you log in, you search for some items, add it to a shopping cart, check out, and it says thanks for the payment. So when you have a test that just does this much, that's a sort of an end-to-end test, right? Those kind of tests are ideally done at the UI level. I think I should enhance this slide. You see, the interesting thing about this sort of a pyramid structure, we call this the test pyramid. Just search for the test pyramid and you'll see a bit of a write-up. The interesting thing about such a test structure is a test that fails here tells you that something failed. It would tell you things like login failed or I could not add to cart. A service level test is one that says, this tells you what failed, add to cart failed. This service level test would tell you where did it fail. That's why you would say, oh, this service could not talk to that service. Why? Your API signature changed or it talked to it, but you know the response was something else. The unit test is the one that tells you why it failed. This is the one that says, you know, I received three parameters, but I used only two of them. Things like that are what you catch with unit level tests, right? So what failed? Where did it fail? Why did it fail? So once we're able to explain to auditors that, look, this is the approach that we take to make sure that the application is robust, okay, they realize that, okay, so these guys, you know, they have removed a lot of the human element out of the testing and they have automated those things. This is important. Muthu?
Yeah, I just want to add on something here. So it's in the shape of a pyramid for a reason, because tests have cost. So we don't write tests just to get an auditor sign off. It helps us with quality control. So that makes a build a good build. As in, a developer commits a code change, and how to make sure that that code change is not going to regress any functionality that's already in production if all of these tests pass. And why do we have more unit tests than service tests? That's because it's more cost effective to write. I mean, it's easier to write unit tests. It takes less time, it has more value, and it gives you quick feedback. The feedback, the cycle time is so short. A developer checks in, these are the set of tests that will be run first. So this is, even if there is a functional test failure, whenever there is a functional test, UI test failure, we will try to write a failing unit test before fixing it so that we catch it early on in the cycle rather than late.
Actually, this brings up a very important point, okay? We don't write our tests on approved code. So there are organizations where what everyone does is they say, let's write the tests, let's deploy to, let's say, a QA environment. Let the QAs give a sign off, let everyone say, yes, this looks like a good build. And then some dev team or whoever would take that, or you'll have a separate unit testing team, they'll now take up that code and start writing unit tests. There are companies who would like to do things like this. What we know by experience is that's not really the right way to go about it. I'm just putting it out there. I would like to debate it some other day, if you don't mind. Because we want to tell you a very important thing. Because we explained these things to the auditors, we were able to talk to them next about pipelines. So a pipeline, and we don't use things like Jenkins. We use more advanced things than that, open source. We have this concept called a pipeline. Okay. Remember, please note, this is not just a visual indicator. That I've used, you know, a pick is worth 1,000 words. But a pipeline, you saw the test in the earlier slide. This is how we run them. Unit first, integration next, functional after that, and then regression, which is just what every end-to-end or whatever critical test would have identified. Often it is bugs that have come up in the past, which you want to catch and make sure you're not regressed again, whatever those sorts of tests are. The point of having a pipeline, especially one that's automated, is as you go through this from left to right, okay, you can have an increase in confidence in the commit or the set of commits that went in. So please understand this. We've said fully automated, and I said in the commit or set of commits that went in. That's because when we set up our CI systems, we don't build every night. We set up the CI system to poll at maybe a 1 or 5 minute interval. And I commit a check-in. Someone has a, you know, they are waiting to check in, but the CI system detected it. It went ahead and began the whole pipeline process. So this much, we made sure that we always have this automated. And the build that comes out of this, we send it off for manual pen testing, right? Or for showcases or other such local checks. So just to go back to the previous slide, these kind of tests are run over here. and we were able to show this to the auditor, and she liked it. Because now, when we see the message about continuous delivery is, your code should always be in a production-ready, ever-deployable state. And we want to tell them, we want to deploy every week. On what basis do they give a sign-off? So we were able to show that we are not skipping testing. This is how we do it. We are not skipping human pen tests. That's how that is over there. Right? And as a consequence, we were able to get a go-ahead for a typical workflow that was like this, where we get whatever requirements are. We have the dev, QA, pen test, and showcase phase. This happens as much as possible. We release it into a UAT environment. External people can pen test if they would like to. And of course, performance tests run all the time. There's a whole separate slide on this and some interesting stuff there. And once all this is ready, we are ready to deploy to prod. Muthu? Ken? Okay. Yeah. The next thing that we explained to our auditors, so you see a lot of these things were very interesting for them. Because they're all used to this, you have a development phase, then regressions will start in 2 weeks. All those things, right? And we said, here's our regression. We commit, we are ready with regression, done in 25 minutes, the whole thing's through. Right? So because we were able to show these and they enjoyed it, we then took them to something like this. Right? Where we said, a hypervisor infrastructure was VMware. So what we were able to explain, and this was a whole audited process, okay? We said, look, you know, even the VMs that come up, they come from approved templates. And how do you approve templates? We had a proper CI setup for that, wherein we show that this is a Red Hat ISO image. Here's the GPG key for, you know, the GPG file for it. We finish a validation. Use VMware API, start up a VM, prepare a VM with the whole OS installed. Convert it into a template. Just this bit of a process, we were able to establish that there's no human intervention in this. Zero human intervention, and now that's become a template. If you ever would like to suspect a template, no problem. Compare checksums, compare everything. This flow gives you an approved template. Right? This, okay, I just said approved template. You see, I should have said automatically created template. The approval was just saying, yes, use Red Hat Linux CD. That's what that was, right? Even the operating system, however, we were able to show that it comes, it is automatically provisioned into the VM used to create a template. We were able to trace all this. Here's the kickstart, all the RTM files are with GPG checks turned on, and you know the whole script is revision controlled, the whole CI system knows exactly which shasm of the source control system it took to make it happen. We were able to demonstrate all this. So from an infra auditing point of view, we got a very good check off for these. And then began all of these. You see, one of the things we wanted to tell them was, we sometimes may just destroy an environment and create it again. One very nice situation. We were talking to one of the senior government officers before we had shown them all this, we just had it running. You see, we made a mistake of assuming, right? As you, me, right? That was my mistake over there. I argued with him for about 2-3 days, and he said, hey Ram, you know, you guys set up all this infrastructure with such pain, man. Why do you want to destroy all your environments? And I realized, oops, I didn't showcase. So we came and showcased all this to them. Then we were able to show them that something like a 23-25 virtual machine environment, with all of this done, we were able to finish it in 5 minutes. Why? Because that's the time that VMware takes. Click a button, make sure it's approved, check in your environment configuration, like how many VMs and such, let VMware take care of it. We are able to do that. We do not buy any tools like, you know, VMware Director or Cloud or vCloud or anything. There's standard open source tools available. VMware supports the API. You can just program it. You do not have to spend thousands of dollars on tools. You see, the second thing that we were able to show the auditors was, we do not want to buy a tool. We don't need an official approver or raise a ticket system and other such things, right? Someone who owns an environment now has the ability to click a button, delete the VMs, spin them up. This is the time. In the time that I spoke to you on this slide, perhaps we would have had an environment come up. Perhaps, right? We were also able to show that all of these things are revision controlled from source. You name it, like auditing rules, monitoring and logging, all the network services, SSHD and whatnot, certificates with which we connect here and there, full machine configuration, all of these completely automated and checked in to revision control systems, deployed, and we can verify the origin of each of these. So once we were, I must say, if I were to sit and do this from scratch on my machine, it would take me maybe a week. But when you have to go into any existing organization where they have a lot of processes, implementing something like this, perhaps even in the dev environment, might take a month. Right? Because you have to convince people, encourage them to give up a bit of control while you do this and ramp them up. Taking it all the way to product can take a few months more. That's the reality check. But the benefits are really awesome, because imagine being able to recreate an environment on demand, whether test or dev or prod.
Yeah.
Yes?
Let's say there's a new OS patch, so yeah. Will you like destroy your whole VM, update your template and spin again, or will you...
Muthu, go ahead.
Yeah, so the way we handle OS patches is, we have a running production system. We want to apply OS on top of it. If you want to do that in production, you want to do it in all dev environment, because production we obviously cannot destroy and recreate. So the way we do it is, we make production our standard benchmark. That's our reference. And we create a similar reference VM on our dev environment and register it with Red Hat. And then we subscribe to Red Hat. So we get OS patches. So we know with reference to production, every day, so it's a nightly build. Every day we get some patches on top of the reference production. So every time we deploy to any environment, we take all these delta patches from Red Hat and deploy it on all environments. So when we run these tests, can you go back to the previous slide? So yeah. Let's say QA environment or dev environment where we run automated tests, even in those environments, we will be installing all these delta OS patches and making sure all our functional tests pass even with those OS patches, that our application is still working fine. So when we have a good build, that good build contains not only just the application, it also contains OS patches. Our build is everything together. Application, tech stack, OS patches, everything. So when we get a build, we also get set of delta patches. So when we deploy these patches to production, we update the reference. Whenever we update production, we update reference. So our reference is always in line with production.
Our reference of what patches are installed in prod. So look at this. Any of these environments, we would of course know what. But there's one more thing which you've not shown here. That's the box where she, you know, syncs with Red Hat and tests the delta and whatnot, right? The delta that she would do there, she actually ended up writing the whole script at the end. So the thing that we did over there was, we know what we've deployed to prod. We have just pulled in stuff from Red Hat, so we get the delta. That set we would always promote. So this is an interesting question you raised. It made me realize I took this for granted. You see, for us, this whole thing is our deployment bundle. Imagine that, this whole thing being your deployment bundle, being promoted in every environment. So whether dev or QA or pre-prod or staging or perf or wherever, you would always deploy this, always. And we had the ability to, you know, just spin, just revert it back to a known good state or whatever. It depends upon the environment and tooling and all of it, but this would be our deploy bundle.
And this way, if there is a conflicting OS patch, if you're using, for some reason, a system function, we will realize that well in advance in our testing environments, like automated testing environments, and we don't have to, it would not be a surprise in production.
So maybe just to add to this point, mm-hmm. I suppose in your in-house environment, you could connect to the internet, so that's not a problem.
Yes.
You might even be able to run a script to do a YAML update.
So not all of our environments can connect to production, but the one which is pulling the patches can connect to production, and then that promotes the rest of the environments.
We would bundle RPMs.
Okay, but are you using a satellite, or are you creating your own YAML repository and
RO YAML repo?
So you're actually editing your YAML.xml in-house?
Yeah, we would update the package manifest. That is correct.
So the challenge is when you push it into the customer's environment, which is slightly sealed off from the internet, then the challenge will be how do you push it out? Unless
so that because that becomes part of our build, when we push our deploy bundle, all the dependencies will get pushed. And one of the dependencies would be OS patch.
So let's take her point ahead and answer this. So it bears mentioning, I think we forgot to mention it, a lot of these things are all were all delivered as GPG signed RPMs. So what that means is, when we come up with a deployment bundle to, let's say, move into a different environment, into that environment's YUM repository, we would add these GPG signed RPMs and regenerate the package manifest. So we did not have, you know, we didn't have a satellite license and all that. This was our plan B. And everyone was fine because we have full traceability of the GPG signed RPM, so it was good. Yes, sir.
But isn't it working around the license model right now? You're having machines that you use in production, and you don't register them actually with satellite, only one machine is registered?
So I can answer that right away. We never had satellite. We just did not have satellite. What we had to do instead was purchase Red Hat licenses. Okay. So for example, in the provider's environment, our client, when they subscribed over there, they were already paying for those licenses. In the data center where we provided, we already had purchased Red Hat licenses per physical VMware box. So our costs, for example, were the Dell hardware, VMware to run the hypervisor. We could have done Red Hat KVM, but no, we chose to stick with VMware. So we also purchased something called the Red Hat Data Center Edition. So what that gives you is that lets you run up to 500 VMs in parallel on one physical server. So that is the approach that we took. So we actually have a ticket filed with Red Hat. You know, they are moving from that old registration model to this so-called new one. We told them, guys, when we register with you, okay, using your new approach, we want to find out what are the packages that should have been applied into this. That is not a solved problem yet. I still have this ticket. She raised it. It's still open a year later. That is still open. So we had to resort to generating our own Delta manifest. See, the approach that we really wanted, I'd like to take this a bit because you mentioned satellite. So for those who have not used, you know, this Red Hat Linux thing, here's what happens. Okay, it's very interesting. They give you this subscription model. If you have computers that cannot connect to the internet, they sell you something separate called satellite. That's cool. Suppose you don't have satellite, then what they urge you to do is something called an offline registration. But you see, now that we are moving to a new model, that offline registration and getting what's applicable on doesn't work. So ideally, what you should be able to do is take a computer, register it with Red Hat, and then go to the dashboard and say, tell me what packages are applicable over here. That way, you should be able to prove to an auditor, my machine is always patched and up to date, right? But we didn't have, it's a procurement thing. If in the procurement cycle or whenever you did not say that I need the software, you're not going to be able to buy it. Worse, you can't even give it for free. We had a situation where we had to give Sophos and it just cost $200, but there's a lot of paperwork. So it was unfortunate for both of us, we went through it. But you see, in the government space, right, if you do not declare it at the start that for this project I need this software, if your required software is not in that list, it is unfortunately a hard time for one and all, right? So,
okay,
I have two more short questions. So the first one you should be able to answer. Is there a license, or is there any way, I mean, if you test, right, and you test bigger environments, you create 50 Red Hat instances, and then you destroy them again, create them again, destroy them again, create them. Is there any development license from Red Hat where they say, hey, you can have Red Hat Enterprise and you can do whatever you need to do in your development stuff without, I mean, I know that they have one developer program where you can have one license for yourself.
Yes. So that was a one developer program license thing, but that's for one instance.
Yeah.
Now you see, in our development environment, we had like around 250 odd virtual machines. So forget it, we put in the money and just procured a production grade license for even our dev environments. What to do? That was the first question.
Yeah. Yeah, the second question, I don't know if you have heard of Aptly, which is a tool that solves this problem in the
dev space. Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
And where you... The problem is that you have a public repository which is run by some DBR maintainers or Ubuntu, and when they update packages, they delete the old version. Which means that once they do this, you can't recreate a machine in the same state as it was
in the past.
Other machines in the So, I use Apple for this. And
yes.
I know that the guy who developed it, he wanted to integrate the YUM part of it too, so that you can use the same thing, which means you will update, you have a local mirror, you update it, and then you can do a snapshot.
Yes. Yeah. And then and refer to that
exactly
at least.
This day, this
I use so-and-so snapshot, yeah. Yes. Muthu, you have to tell him why you're not developing your software in open source. So it's something, I mean, I think we should all tell her, please open source your ideas.
No.
She's not doing it yet.
Go into that open source project aptly and then
sure.
offer
sure.
your
sure.
help
yeah.
to integrate. It's a nice Go project. So
yes.
And he's looking for people who will help him maintain the project.
Yeah.
So maybe correct us.
Yes, sir.
Sorry, I'm going to be presumptuous about this. We have worked on a particular project. We have simply for the fun of it, we got a repository from an authenticated source, mm-hmm. and then formed Red Hat and pushed it down to CentOS.
Mm-hmm. Oh,
simply for the fun of it.
Okay.
Simply for the fun of it, not for commercial reasons. Then we trashed it. We repeated the process, and we convinced ourselves that it's a bad idea, because as long as it's not authenticated, you can get. We have 10 servers, one server has a license, the other 9 doesn't have the license. If you fuck up the other 9, you go to Red Hat catches you,
yeah.
your pants down.
Right.
So you have to trouble. You can declare it in advance, but your pants are down.
Yeah.
So nonetheless, I think you can always discuss with the local account manager, the APEC account manager, and they can work out some creative arrangements for you. But suffice to say that if you are going to manage your own Dell repository, it's very dangerous.
Yeah.
Because there are a lot of unauthenticated Red Hat repositories out there. Some which seem authentic, some which are not. And the problem is really with the YUM XML and also with the authenticity. So granted, you can do GPG, but you could also get things which look authentic but which are not. So once you have the right licenses and you want to reiterate that process, because for us, we've tried the YUM repositories, we've done the satellites, we've pushed it out, we've done the scripts, and it worked for us.
Yeah.
For us, the challenge in OS patches was one, Red Hat can support the list of applicable patches for us, but even if Red Hat were to support it, we cannot just apply all the applicable patches on production directly. So if we take a build, we have to make sure we have to identify the set of patches which we have tested and only apply those. That's where the challenge for us was. So I might have gotten deltas as of today, but if I choose the build from last week to be deployed to production, then the OS patches should be of that build, not of today. Yes.
Yeah.
Sorry, so just in the interest of time, can we save the questions for later? Because you do have another speaker as well after this. So.
Okay. Yeah, so I guess this is what we want to say. If you have the right kind of, if you can demonstrate auditability and traceability, if you can demonstrate proper code, test coverage, if you can demonstrate that you're able to do this fast enough and that, you know, you're not just deploying to prod because you have the automation. If you can demonstrate things like that, then you can have continuous delivery, right? That means always be production delivery. Ready. CD is not continuous deployment, it is continuous delivery. Be able to deploy, be prod ready, not my test pass, I'm going to prod. Depends on the application, of course, but you know, not everyone in the world is all these e-commerce sites where they'll just roll back. Sorry.
Actually, one interesting thing in government is we said the measures of success is different, right? So how do we just deploy every time? So why do we need such a robust CI system? Because even more than private sector, government has to respond to change very quickly. Mm-hmm. If something like control is all it is about. If something goes wrong, I want to be in a controlling position and I want to control what is there and I want to revert back. Or if I want to put in a quick fix, it may not always be a rollback, it could be a roll forward, but I want to quickly deploy. It could be just a single line of change, it could be an exchange, but how long does it take to fix things in production? That's why we may not deploy every hour or every day even, but when we have to deploy, we should be able to deploy within the shortest time possible.
So we had two interesting things, okay? We did not mention these here. See, one thing that we explained to all was, we are going to roll back only if we cannot roll forward. That means because we have such high speed turnaround times, we would prefer to be able to roll forward than roll back. While we have so much of testing and whatnot in place, there were other departments or other agencies that we connected to. You know, they provide their own API endpoints. They'll tell you something, they may not have a staging environment, that's their reality, so you test with them in prod. Now you test with them in prod and you tell them, hey, you know, you said you'd give me a value 302, but you're giving me a 200. What does this mean? And they'll say, yeah, sorry, it's an issue, but you see someone else had signed it off. So even though you may call it a defect, it was signed off, so that means it's now a separate change request, and God bless everyone on when it will get done. So we can't wait for all that, we have to turn around quick. That's why it was in our advantage that we had all of these things and all of this and all of this. It was in our advantage to have it all in place. It's a very important thing for us. And just to reiterate that point, we said our goal is to go to be able to roll forward and not to roll back. Muthu, do you want to take this?
Yeah. So in governments, okay, in a typical e-commerce environment or in private sector, if it's a good build, then we can just go ahead and deploy. Or we don't even need anybody to deploy, it will just get deployed. That's the norm. But in government space, can anybody deploy a good build, given just that it's good, we've run all those tests, so our performance testing has passed, pen testing has passed, so can it be deployed? No, unfortunately, because there is an approval process. It is there and we just have to adhere to it. So how do we still achieve CI given this constraint? So authorization is embedded within our deployment process itself. So when our so we have somebody called the environment owner. So for a QA environment, our QA would be the environment owner. He will be the one who will have access to deploy and he can just deploy whenever he like. But if it's production, then our product owner is our environment owner. So she or he has to approve that. Given that it is a good build, it still can be deployed because it could be policy changes. Before government can roll out that policy changes over the internet, they have to announce it to the world that there is indeed a policy change. So there will be time and period when they can deploy. So it can't just be deployed just because it has passed all the tests. So yes. So how do we embed authorization? So our product owner. It is actually going through a ticketing process. As our product owner approves a ticket to deploy a specific card, we will have a tag that will make sure that these are the changes that has to be deployed. And before deployment, we have additional checks which will ensure that the tag matches the set of changes that's coming in. And if it matches, only then it's going to deploy. So that gave our product owner a lot of confidence, and that also gave us visibility because our product owner can clearly see what is right now in production and what are the changes that are going to go through as part of this future deployment, and can they go, she'll have clarity on those requirements, and if they are ready to be deployed, then she will approve it and then it will be deployed, and as it gets deployed, she can see and track that these are the changes. So when I say track, it is including the functional specifications, OS patches, everything that's in the deploy bundle, everything is traceable.
Yeah. Muthu, you take this.
Okay, I'll try. So security. So yes, we know security is important for government applications. Penetration testing, like we pointed out earlier in our pipelines, it is part of our deployment process. Every good build, if it has to be deployed, we'll go through penetration testing, and if there are issues, the cycle will go back and we'll fix it and we'll get a new build and then only we'll go to production deployment. So we need security clearance before a new build can be deployed. And it's not just once in a while that just before production deployment we do security testing. It's embedded in our development process itself. So we had a security tester in our team who tests regularly all our changes and make sure that we don't have any last minute surprises just before deploying.
And we made it mandatory.
So security clearance is mandatory for production deployment. Only if it is cleared. In all the 2 years that we spent in this project, our external pen testers didn't even find a single security defect.
I mean, they found stuff, it was not really relevant to us. Some other front-ending load balancer or whatever. So, yeah. Right?
Performance. One thing is performance of any application is important for user experience, and because customer satisfaction is of high importance to the government, that's really important. And even otherwise, our payments are linked to the performance SLAs, so the uptime and how fast the response time was and all of it. So how do we ensure that we don't break or we don't slow down, our, like our system doesn't slow down as due to some of the changes that goes in new build? So that's part of our development process itself. Like one of those pipelines that we saw earlier, performance testing is a pipeline. So it is automated. It generates automated performance testing reports. So every, we can run it as often as we want to, but we run it every day. So every day, all the changes that went through today will be run tonight and will go to performance testing pipeline. So that will test whether our functionality is right, whether all our load times, all our response times, is our the database good, is our CPU good, memory good, all of it will be tested and we'll get automated reports on that. So if even if something breaks, we have time to fix it and it's proactive.
I must tell you that as a sysadmin, I really enjoyed this project, not just because it taught me a lot by way of due diligence in the security space, but also in the performance space. Just imagine, so we had SLA parameters like CPU utilization should not, so they had a limit called warning. Okay, warning was set to 60%. So we had performance SLAs, payments and penalty linked to this, where it says, you should not touch or breach warning more than 3 consecutive 5-minute samples. Like I sample now, I sample. If this third time also it has touched or exceeded 60%, sorry, it's a performance SLA breach, you don't get paid. How awesome is that? So, and this payment was, you know, you have this thing called, it was very interesting for us, okay? Because unlike many other projects,
we see don't people recommend laughing. It or advise it.
Yeah.
To
so, look, I'll tell you something interesting, right? This is a concept called the performance guarantee period. Yeah, so you have this notion called the performance guarantee period. What is this performance guarantee period? The intent is, in the waterfall approach, when you're finished developing something, you put it into a production environment, make sure you know all app issues and such are fixed, and then for a particular duration of 21 or 27 days, there should be no breaches. Okay, after that period, then begins a warranty period, and then you know, everything else is paid. Okay, sounds good. You see, the unique thing for us was, we had already gone live about 1.5 years ago. By the time we were done with the replacing the last functionality, our first deployment had already taken place some 21 months ago. Right? So in all that time, our app was actually live and we kept maintaining performance. Right? And yet, because the contract said so, even after our last deployment, we had to sit through a performance guarantee period like that. App's working. We have all of this. The contract says so, so no problem. What else to do? You have to go through it.
Sir,
yes, sir.
You also said that you have an orchestration process where you spin up the...
Yeah.
But at the same time, you're saying like, for 21 months, your performance tests have been running. Are they not...
We are running... No, not performance. We are live in production for 21 months. So this context is, we were replacing an existing web apps functionality, module by module. So the first replacement was in December 2014. And then we are just going through all of it.
I think this question is related to environment creation, right?
Yeah, so my question is, so in the performance test, okay, the thing is like, in reality, like in most of your tests or most of your production system, it fails because of the load in actual environment and the load in dev environment, or you know, the kind of transaction happening in production is not similar to what you find in dev or UAT or SIP.
Very nice.
So you need to like, you know, back up those transactions. You need to have some mechanism to find out, replay, you know, those kind of
stuff. Actually, that's a very good question. We missed to mention it. So our performance testing environment is the only environment which replicates the production data load. So we have anonymous data dumped from production and we use that in our performance testing environment. So we make sure that and all our loads, like if we have four servers in production, we have four servers of the same load in performance testing environment. It's an exact replica and we simulate the same load, and that's how we make sure the other two, I mean, our performance tests are really testing real-time performance.
Plus, our performance guarantee was not on the basis of present load, but 5 years from now. So we used to run, yeah. So 5 years projected load, we used to run it now.
And like your normal test also in, you know, your UAT environment. So are those also having negative tests, or you know, does it have some dump from production?
Yes.
Do you get that?
Yes.
But maybe the load wouldn't be similar to production, but yes.
That was more from functionality
so,
point of view.
Yeah, so like that reminds me of, you know, the system gets bricked, you know, not because of new deployment, or not because of new changes, but probably how it was used, and then the new deployment goes in. So in production, you cannot just like scrap it and then, you know, put it new. So that reminds me of an example of like iOS 10 of, you know, Apple came, right? So they immediately have to come up with a patch because it was not able to install on all of the iPhones, although they have tested it like 100 times with the same build, same, but not with the same dev set. So something I've screwed up. In fact, my phone was the one, you know.
Oh.
So okay. I reported that, and so I have to restore my phone
and all of that.
And I didn't have the backup.
Oops.
Right. Yeah, I would say things will go wrong even after all this. That is especially why we should have all these processes in place so that
you can respond to change.
We can respond very quickly.
And roll forward. Yeah. With you on that. I'd like to go to the... Yes, sir.
Sorry, I hate to do this, but we do have to progress. So maybe you can save it for after the presentation where you can ask them directly.
Maybe the very short one I can ask.
Okay.
I don't know yet about how many people did work on this project to make it work.
Beyond how many were...
When we were the most, when I was there, we were 50 people in the room.
Yeah, that was a whole application, 47 or something. But to do just this work, we were anywhere between 4 to 5 of us. 4 to 5 of us, it took, I would say the first cut of it took about 3 months, and then there were improvements as we went along. Yeah, I'd like to talk about this. It's our last slide, actually. Working with infrastructure constraints, right? So this has been widely published, you know, the government has decided to make sure that a lot of networks are segregated. Post-Snowden, I'm sure they must have some major insights into what else could go wrong. But we also had to work with it. So you see, we didn't have things like automated promotion of artifacts into other environments. So the environments in which we built were not connected to anything by which we could promote the artifacts. So since then, right? So anyway, in this project, we just survived it. It was unfortunate. We had to do stuff like connect over here, take your government secured hard disk drive, download artifacts into it, connect somewhere and upload. We were not too worried because of a lot of our tests, we did not really have to ever, you know, we did not really encounter very many bugs in prod. And whenever we had to deploy, we would deploy on a Wednesday. That was our day. You know, on a Wednesday, 7 p.m., we go live with a new build. Right, so we were kind of fine with that. Though since then, there are some other government-linked companies we are in conversations with. And what we've helped them understand is, yes, you can and perhaps should have network segregation, but you also can think about automated promotion of assured artifacts across these environments. So that is a discussion that has now begun, and I'm involved in those things. That's one. The second thing is, Muthu, do you want to take this ticketing system?
Yes. So, if it's our own data center and if you're controlling the complete infrastructure, then if you want to switch a service from port A to port B, then we just open firewalls and we just get it done. I mean, it's a non-event, it doesn't take any time at all. and we just folder, we just change the infrastructure scripts and just be done. But unfortunately, we had to rely on some other infrastructure provider, which means we have to go through a ticketing system, and it might take any time between days to months to get even the smallest of the infrastructure change done. And we just survived with it. I mean, we handled it in a different way. Like, we will use IP tables forwarding. Like, we will know what port is open or what are the resources available. Port is just an example, be it anything. And we just work within those constraints and make it happen. It may not be the ideal thing. That is not what we would do if we had control. But given this constraint, we just have to make do with it.
Yeah. This is another thing, limited access to production, right? We had to figure out some creative ways in which we make sure that things like, how do you make sure devs can access prod? This is a strict no, right? In terms of so-called segregation of duties, which there are better ways to handle it nowadays. We had to work around those systems. We had to work with those systems. Because of our success over here, our clients were highly supportive. They would often sit with us while we diagnose and debug prod issues, and we get into those boxes and review logs and whatnot. There were those of us who were security cleared so that we could review a lot of logs ourselves. What we realized was this, the sheer pain of sometimes getting into certain boxes was so much. We try to compensate that by making sure we have a lot of monitoring, auditing rules, logging, and all of those things set in place. We had an intense amount of logging and log alerts and whatnot. Yeah, this is something that we were pretty pleased about. We had a lot of proactive alerts on possible issues. We have faced situations where network service providers in between would suddenly change firewall rules, or they would install a patch or apply some random policy, which, you know, causes issues to us. And then, you know, it's a great circus of trying to figure out whom to talk to, right? So instead of users telling us, we made sure that we had all manner of checks all across the way. For example, it's a very well-known thing. If you have an IDS or, let's say, IPS system in place and you're making an open SSL connection somewhere, a simple telnet port check is not enough. The IPS will respond to you and say, oh yeah, I can connect you there, right? You have to do stuff like run an open SSL client, connect to the other side, download the server-side certificate, compare it with the last known cert, and raise an alert in case there are changes. We have to do stuff like, you know, when the OpenSSL vulnerabilities just kept coming up, we got into issues where a day before we went live, or maybe 2 days before we went live, they had suddenly gone and changed the SSL policies, right? They just dropped SSL 1 and 2 and said it's just SSL 3. Or maybe it was SSL 3, yeah. You see, we were still on an older build of Red Hat Linux, and there were certain apps we were using. Those were not able to recognize this new protocol and cert enforcement. And we were just in a very, very bad situation.
And we were in an older build of Red Hat again because of our infrastructure provider.
Yeah. So it was like really messy for us. We had to work on at the last minute, replace one web server, another, change a bit of the app, God knows what not. Okay, it was not a day before, but 4 days before go live, but you know, right? What the hell? So, something to live with, but proactive alert and monitoring on a whole lot of things.
And what this helps us with is customer satisfaction, because even before the affected customers would call in, we know there is an issue, and if we tell our customers, they would trigger the standard SOP. They'll get the call centers ready, they'll be prepared for customers, and if there's something that we could do to fix it, it's not always out of our control. If it is in our control, then we could fix it before somebody is affected.
Mm. But one thing.
So after we deployed our application, when compared to the legacy system, the number of calls that comes to the call center for issues have come down drastically.
Yeah.
I don't know the exact numbers.
Yeah. So we're not sales, so we'll not throw some random, 30% calls reduced or whatever. But they were reduced enough that people were wowed. And I guess this is the last slide. In summation, what I would say is I personally kind of enjoyed it because I ended up becoming a better quality-minded person. My due diligence levels have improved vastly. When I document or read something, or when I even respond, I think now in multiple aspects. I worked in many countries around the world, okay, and I was really, really pleased. And I guess I kind of understood the the Singaporean spirit of wanting to always be the best in the world. You know, it doesn't matter how much, we have to be the best. Or, you know, hey, this had better not regress, you know. And when you look at how well the country is run and everything, you realize it. It's all these people, civil servants, who want the best and they're doing the best that they can. I walked away very impressed, I must tell you. I was really impressed. Return.
Please, Satya Manon, so I'm just going to tell the story on how civil servants try to be
proactive
customers, right? Yeah. Our product owner actually shared her own credit card details to a random user because they were not able to pay with their expired credit card in our app. I mean, she really wanted to help that elderly customer. The customer yeah. didn't understand that there is this concept of expired cards. So, yeah, she shared her credit card details to a random user so that they could pay and use this application. I mean, that's how much the civil servants of this country is.
Yeah, we were really, really, really impressed. Because of a lot of our proactive alerting and logging and everything, we often got into situations where we would notice something, you know, we'd get an alert, the user's still trying it out. And we tell one of these civil servants who we are working with, they'd give them a call and say, hey, our system has detected you're trying to do something, it's a mistake from our side, sorry, please try again in 5 minutes or whatever. And we're having a fix ready for you. I guess the last closing note, the success of all this is a case where Muthu and our BA were talking to our product owner. There was something that had happened, okay, and the fix was either approach A or B. And they just looked at her and said, you have to tell us. We'll be done in an hour. But you have to tell us, do you want approach A or B? So they were not used to this. I mean, they were used to a life where they'll tell us today. We'll have a triaging meeting next week. And it'll be delivered in some other month's delivery cycle. But here we scared the hell out of them. Tell us, do you want approach A or B? You tell me. It was pretty cool to be able to do that. Okay, we're done. Your last question.
Who?
Yeah, you had a question.
Yes.
Yeah.
Problems come from the application and the systems, but you said that you automated a lot. So
yes.
There's a lot of new kind of problems coming from the automation side, where you also have updates of the automation software, scripts going bad. You have a lot of things somewhere running in the background, hard to debug, hard to see what's going on. How did you deal?
Was the wildest bad adventure. I have dealt with stupid things like IDS signatures changed like that, random patches applied, some HP software changed.
Did you ever get to a point where you found that the automation part of it is stabilizing or?
So you know what? In all of these, we ran the entire automation scripts. So if you had an issue, we'd catch it here or even earlier. So if you had issues, we'd catch it there. We'd not catch those in prod. But other things in prod where they just change beyond all of automation scripts, really bad number of issues. Like firewall policies change, some patch applied by somebody else, some HP tracking tool has been revised so it hung. Oh. One of our PGP SLAs had once got breached. And it was after a lot of begging that we could make them see that there was a SAN level failure. It was miserable. Very miserable. I can tell you this.
I have a question.
Yes, sir.
So may I know how long it takes to complete a fully automated pipeline? And is it really no manual testing involved? Because as I know, we do exploratory testing.
Yes. So you do have exploratory testing. The thing in our world is, do you see this? QA. So we have dev, QA, pen testing, and showcase. And by dev, I don't mean just a dev environment. The whole dev is this whole flow. Mm-hmm. But then the QA, they click, deploy their own environment, get the app in it, and perform the exploratory testing.
Okay.
That is correct.
Okay. So the pipeline doesn't complete in just 1 hour. It can be more than 1 hour, depends on.
Hey, you know what? This is a very interesting thing. You see, I must say, okay, the tool and the technology is maybe just 10% of the effort. A lot of making these sorts of things happen is a lot of people and process and getting the right mindset. Okay, you cannot buy a stupid enterprise Jenkins or you know some IBM Erkund code or some DB deploy or whatever and say, I have paid $15 million, I've got the right tools, I'm sure we've got continuous delivery now. Why? Because my Excel spreadsheet says so. cannot happen like that, right? For a lot of these things, I really like the question you asked. You see, for us, right from the time the dev commits and does all of these things, the QA is involved even before in the requirements phase itself. The security guy is involved in the requirements phase. When the devs say, okay, I've done all of this, and let me just, yeah, and it's ready for showcase. Before that, the QAs come to the dev machine and do a dev machine check. Like right there, okay, you committed it, you think it looks good. Before we move it to done, let me see, does it actually work?
We call it a test check.
DevOps test check. And then before we showcase, you know, we would showcase to the client every Tuesday, 5 p.m. Before we showcase to the client, of course, we try out the whole thing ourselves, isn't it? We do all of those things.
To go back to your question, right? So if there is going to be manual QA, how do we still quickly respond to change within 1 hour, say? If we have to quickly respond to change, then it's just one issue that we are focusing on that time. So like Ram said, QAs will be involved even in the requirements phase. While a dev is fixing the bug, he will know what the bug is, and he would have come up with all the possible scenarios that he would have to test once it is fixed, and so on. So by the time a dev pushes it, QA will quickly pull it and test it while all these automation tests are being run. So it's parallel, and so it's still the short time.
So the QA actually like work one sprint behind the dev?
No. In parallel with the dev.
There's no rule as such. They just work in parallel with the